I think that success helps one's sense of self-confidence. I enjoyed writing my first book. I've been married 21 years, so I think we feel very secure together, my husband and myself. But I also feel very confident that I can write and can be accepted on my own grounds.
In her own image. In her own image. Anna, the labor union situation in New York, Hinton at the end, Albert. Yarrow and Albert become friends.
Yes.
She realizes that she can deal with him. But in the end, he's sort of booed. He is thrown out by the unions.
Yes, I took that really from the newspaper reports of the time of the 62-63 mm-hmm. dispute, which fascinated me and surprised me. And I followed those reports very closely because I had not understood the power games within unions. We all see not only newspapers as being sort of one conglomerate and all the publishers, mm-hmm. but we also see unions as one sort of power block. But within it, you have all these little fiefdoms and people arguing among themselves. And that interested me, and if I could bring that out in the book, it made it more interesting.
Do you see television, because Yarrow also gets into owning TV and radio stations, is that the next step for tabloid journalism?
I thought you were going to say, is that my next book?
maybe. That's the next question, right.
I think that television is tabloid journalism. I think that's exactly what it is, which always surprises me why they accuse us so much of having too much frivolity and so on. We're all out there to sell something. So you package it. You have your soaps, you have your news, you have your editorials. You have everything in it. You have talk shows, you have chats, you have columns. I don't see any difference in them except in the medium by which it's presented.
But then what happens to something called in-depth? What happens to examining a subject and helping your reader or audience achieve a political view?
Well, I hope that we never lose readers, but we know ourselves that fewer and fewer people read. I think it is a difficulty. All those shows, in-depth reporting and so on, get very small, not readership, viewership.
And Anna, we're going to take a short pause, and we'll be back with our guest, Anna Murdoch, author of Family Business. Welcome back. We're talking with Anna Murdoch, author of Family Business, and we're coming to you from L'Hermitage Hotel in Beverly Hills. Anna, readership gets smaller for newspapers, larger for TV, and yet books have never been healthier.
I'm glad to hear it.
So, I ask you your own question. It's the next one on television.
I don't know. I have to do a lot of research into it. I've begun reading for my next book to get some background, but I haven't begun writing yet. Time will tell.
Talk a little bit then. The pleasure of writing, mm-hmm. the rewriting process, and how you develop a character like a Yarrow and an Elliot.
Well, sometimes the character comes to your head first, which did with Yarrow in her own image, in Family Business. And I could see her very vividly, very, very clearly. I knew that her hair was black. I knew it was a cloud of hair, curly hair. This is probably wishful thinking since I have straight hair. I knew she had wide gray eyes. I could absolutely see her. I knew what weight she was. I knew everything that would happen to her. My first book came from an image I had in my head mm-hmm. of children running across a garden in Australia with a man carrying a cake. I don't know where that image came from. And in fact, I actually cut it out of the book. But it was from that image that I began working on the story, mm-hmm. backwards and forwards. And I remember reading something by a wonderful man who wrote The Jewel and the Crown, Paul mm-hmm. Scott, on writing, in which he said that his books began with an image and that he would see something in his mind and he would only work with it if he could actually think all around it and go through the front door of it and out the back door of it.
Do you go into your own mind then as you are writing?
Yeah, very much so. Yeah.
What happens then to the rest of your life during that period?
I get very forgetful. I mean, I really do. I love writing. I think probably I'm a loner at heart. I'm terribly happy to be in my mind and writing. In fact, at one stage when I was going for my deadline with this book, I was in Colorado writing, and I have an attic which I was in, where you cannot stand up unless you put your head out the skylight, which I would do when my printer was chugging away, and I would cry. There were two or three spots in the book where I would burst into tears at what was happening to my characters. And I really thought that I was the mad woman in the attic, you know, totally on her own, really living this book.
Is that the house that Yarrow builds?
Yes, but the great thing about writing a book is you can do all of your redecorating, push out walls, and you don't have to put up with anybody coming in and doing it. It's very inexpensive.
When you said that about crying, I did cry as I read this book, and that's when Zeb dies.
Yes, yeah, I was very upset then.
I hope to God you haven't lost a child then.
No, but I think it's one of the worst things that any mother could imagine. I'm a Jewish mama at heart, and I really did know this would happen to Yarrow, and it did.
Because it is such a Greek tragedy. I mean, you could hear her almost hallooing to the clouds with her anger, her misery at the death of this child. Mm-hmm. And maybe even a bit of her own guilt for having made Sandy take the child out that day.
Yes, I'm sure that was there.
Yeah.
And she also came out of it much stronger at the end. In a way, these things are sent to Yarrow like tests, and she overcomes them. She's able to use them to her advantage.
And a wonderful book, a wonderful, you know, there haven't been that many novels lately that one can say, gee, I can really sit and read it and not say, well, when the plane lands in 2 hours, I've finished the book. I'd like to present you with L'Hermitage's Secretary in a Box
Thank
for
you
your
very
travels
much.
On the book.
Thank you.
And their
it.
Lovely cologne for women.
Thank
and
you.
Also their pen to autograph my book.
Love to do that for you, Connie.
And if you would like a copy of our publication, Good Books, write to me, Connie Martinson, P.O. Box 69-1640, Los Angeles, California, 90069. We'll tell you about some other books we've liked recently, or look for our column in Beverly Hills Today, California Press Bureau's 8 newspapers. We also tell you about some of the people we've talked to recently. But a book I'd like to tell you about, Miriam Makeba's book, Makeba. She was born in South Africa, but she had a God-given sound, a voice that brings her to America. Harry Belafonte helped her. Later, their friendship broke because there was a misunderstanding. But this is a woman who has lived a lifetime, brings her back to Africa. Her child does die. The anger, the craziness of the mother who loses a child. One cannot talk. Even explain nature that this can happen. Meanwhile, support your local library. Go in, take out a card, look up In Her Own Image. It's well worth reading. Support an organization called Reading is Fundamental, which helps children learn to collect books. And we'll see you next week. And Anna, thank you so very
thank
much
you,
for
Connie.
Joining me.
It's always a pleasure.